टेस्ट कर देना ना। बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडे टॉपिक फॉर डिस्कशन इज़ द इन्फ्लेमेटरी बाउल डिजीज़। बेसिकली दिस इज़ एन इन्फ्लेमेटरी बाउल डिजीज़ एन इम्यून मेडिएटेड इन्फ्लेमेशन ऑफ द इंटेस्टाइन एंड इट हैज़ मेजर टू टाइप्स। बेसिकली इट इज़ डिवाइडेड इनटू टू टाइप्स, अल्सरेटिव कोलाइटिस एंड क्रोहन डिजीज़। It's an, as I have already told you, that it is an autoimmune mediated disease, and more common is in the European countries. Its cases are reported in Pakistan and other Asian countries, but it is less frequent in our country. It mostly patients are belongs to the European countries. Are there races which are here in Pakistan? Which were migrated long time ago from these areas. Why this happened, its cause is not known, but we have seen that this is mostly occur in the European countries, and their peak of age is the 15 to 30 years, means it's a disease of the young patients. And the risk factor for disease is either due to the some fulminant disease activity or long standing complication. These two things I will discuss in the later part of my lecture. And the 5 to 10% cases are the familial, means it runs in the families. Its exact pathology and why this disease occur, its cause is not known. There are many theories, and theories are based on the facts that there is genetic predisposition, means it runs in families. If the parents have the disease, the siblings have the chances that this disease will goes into them. So this means that genes are transmitted from the genes of the disease are transmitted from the parents to their children. So there is genetic predisposition, where there are the factors which exaggerate the disease or triggers the disease. If the disease is going in a silent way, they trigger the disease. The exogenous factors, smoking, enteric pathogens, means intestinal infections, food contents, certain food products, they trigger the disease or increase the disease severity. Other are the dysregulated immune response against the normal gut commensals and the self antigen. This means autoimmunity. That's why we are calling this as an autoimmune disease. There are several genes which regulate the gut immune response seems to be associated with this disease. And moreover, the exogenous factors are suggested by improvement in disease by the antibacterial agents. Like if the patients have the active disease, then we start giving the antibacterial agents, say ciprofloxacin or flagyl, the means metronidazole, disease gets improved. Or certain probiotics and fecal diversion, all these things improve the disease. So by these facts, we can say that the disease, these factors have relationship with the disease, but we do not know the exactly what is exact relationship of these things with the disease. But we know that these factors either exaggerate the disease or they sometimes they slow down the disease process. So they have certain relationships, but the exact what is actual pathology is not clearly known. We have divided the disease into the two main groups, Crohn disease and ulcerative colitis. There are some differentiating features between the Crohn disease and ulcerative colitis, but I have already told you the main pathology is same. Both are autoimmune diseases. So we because the treatment protocol different for the Crohn disease and ulcerative colitis, we divide it in two parts. First is the location. It usually affects the short bowel, means small intestine is mostly the target of this disease, or large gut, but it can affect any part of the gut. But the ulcerative colitis usually affects the large intestine and rarely affects the small intestine, which is known as backwash ileitis. So we can say that the ulcerative colitis is mainly the disease of the large gut, and Crohn disease mainly affects the small gut, but it can affect any part of the intestinal tract. And other is the anatomic distribution. It produces the scyplians, means it affects the some part of the intestine, and in between part is the normal. But the in ulcerative colitis disease affect in a continuous manner. It begins in some part and then goes away, and then it stopped. So the it affects in a continuous way. But in the Crohn disease, some part is not healthy and some part is affected. So it produces scyplians, means certain part of the intestine is skipped and certain part of the intestine is affected. Rectal involvement means large gut involvement. As I have already told you, ulcerative colitis mostly affects the large gut, so its involvement 95%, and in Crohn disease is often spared. We see the bleeding tendency. Grass bleeding occur in Crohn disease less commonly, only just 25% of the cases patient present with bleeding from the in the stool. But in ulcerative colitis, it is universal, means in all the patients bleeding occurred, small or large quantity. It depends upon the severity, but bleeding is there in the history of the patient, and usually patient present with bleeding per rectum. Perianal disease. In the Crohn disease, there are cases of 75%, and it is ulcerative colitis rarely affect. It affects the large gut, but perianal disease is rare in ulcerative. But in the Crohn disease, 75% have the perianal disease, means there is some fistula or fissure or some like these diseases occur in this cases. Inflammation, it is transmural, means it affects the mucosa and some mucosal area, muscularis, and the outer part of the intestine. But ulcerative colitis usually confined to the mucosal area. Below that submucosa or muscularis area, it rarely goes and affect. So it is a mucosal disease, but Crohn disease transmural effect, and whole thickness of the intestine is affected. Mucosa is friable in the ulcerative colitis, because the only mucosal involvement occur in the ulcerative colitis. It is uncommon in the Crohn disease. Submucosal inflammation, I have already told you, it is common because Crohn disease affects the transmural whole thickness of the intestine. In ulcerative colitis, it is uncommon. Other differentiating feature is the granuloma formation. I have told you that mostly the in previous lectures, granuloma formations occurs in the tuberculosis. But in Crohn disease also the granuloma formation occur in 50 to 75% of the cases. In ulcerative colitis it is rare. Fissures, they are common in Crohn disease, but this is rare in ulcerative colitis. Same is with the fistula formation, this is common in Crohn but rare in the ulcerative colitis. Fibrosis, it is common in the Crohn disease, rare. Longitudinal ulcers, common, but it is rare in ulcerative colitis, means they pose in longitudinal way, but the transverse diameter is not large. Other is the special occurrence is the cobblestone appearance. In severe cases, which is present in the Crohn disease, it is rare. And vascular pattern, it is usually normal in the Crohn disease. When we see in the colonoscopic picture or colonoscopy, we do the colonoscopy, it is normal looking mucosa. But in ulcerative colitis, it is distorted. I have also told you, mostly ulcerative colitis affect the mucosal areas. So this is the picture. I have already told you, it mostly affects the small intestine, but can affect any part of the GI tract. So we can say that can affect any part of the intestinal tract. But ulcerative colitis usually remain confined to the large gut, up to the cecal area. Okay, this is the area which is usually affected by the ulcerative colitis. Sometimes in rare cases, it affects the ileum. So it is called a backwash ileitis. But in the duodenum, jejunum, it rarely affects. But Crohn disease affects duodenum, jejunum, any ileum, any part of the intestine. Now we discuss one by one. Crohn disease. It is a chronic inflammatory disease because it's when started, it has insidious, slowly start, and its time limit is unlimited. So it becomes a chronic. And variable location, sometimes affect the small intestine, large intestine, and any part of the intestine, and with variable intensity of effect. Some areas where the inflammation is severe, some area the inflammation is only mild. And it is usually associated with the low-grade fever, diarrhea, or right lower quadrant pain. And sometimes lower quadrant mass-like appearance occur, and it is tender. So it confused with the diagnosis of appendix sometimes. And there, because it affects the intestine, when the intestine is inflamed, the food contents are not properly absorbed, so patient has the weight loss. And sometimes it has the extra intestinal manifestation like the abscess formation or fistula formation. In the large intestine, conclusion is that it can affect any part of the intestine. It can usually present with low grade fever, right lower quadrant fever, and associated with the abscess or fistula formation. I have not told you that there is any bleeding per rectum. So bleeding per rectum is rare in the Crohn disease. So this is the picture. This is familial tendency. Peak age is the younger patients. Autoimmune presentation is nausea or vomiting, abdominal pain, distension, right lower quadrant pain. Presents with severe diarrhea, low grade fever, sometimes blood stool, but mostly not blood associated, weight loss, severe malabsorption. These are the usually presentation. Blood stool, do not confused, is rare that patient has the blood in the stool. Complication, intra-abdominal abscess formation, intestinal fistula, peritonitis, sometimes perforations occur, and development of the fistula formation. So in the later stage, signs and symptoms are dehydration, electrolyte imbalance, and anemia. So this is the usual presentation of the Crohn disease. This is the risk factor. Genetics, smoking worsen the disease. Autoimmune reaction, NSAIDs can aggravate the disease. Geographic location, mostly in the Western societies. Antibiotics usually improve the severity of the disease. Oral contraceptive pills have the relationship, it usually worsens the disease activity. Crohn disease, it is a stricture formation or fistula formation of the small intestinal occur or large intestinal. Fistula is the tract which opens from one viscera and it opens into the other viscera. And it has, Crohn disease have also the extra intestinal manifestations. Mind it, I am telling you the Crohn disease has the extra intestinal manifestation. It is contrast with the ulcerative colitis, which I will discuss in the later part of my lecture. Extra intestinal manifestations are the oral ulcer or aphthous ulcers, eye manifestation, episcleritis or uveitis, musculoskeletal, spondylitis or arthritis. Patient sometimes presents with the low back pain. It is a common cause of the seronegative arthritis, just like the ankylosing spondylitis, which is also seronegative arthritis. It affects the sacroiliac joints area. So patient have the low back pain. Arthritis, any joints pain or inflammation can occur. Large joints like knee joints, patient may present with arthritis, means joints, swelling of the knee joints. Other skin manifestation are erythema nodosum, I will show you the picture. Pyoderma gangrenosum, I will show you the picture. Hepatobiliary area effect, gallstone formation. So one of the reason of the gallstone formation is the Crohn disease. Other is the sclerosing cholangitis, means their bile ducts are inflamed. and they become diseases sclerosing cholangitis. Other are the renal stone formation, in means ki kidney stone formation. One of the important cause of the kidney stone formation is the Crohn disease. So extra intestinal manifestations usually associated with the Crohn disease, and they are very important. The you must know the what are the extra intestinal manifestations. Sometimes they are asked in the examination. Moreover, stricture or fistula formation are common in the Crohn disease. They are rarely occurred in the, or we can say there are no such cases reported where the ulcerative colitis have the fistula or stricture formation. So this is very important to remember in the Crohn disease. I will show you the picture. This is the fistula formation from the viscera. This is the tract which goes out. So this is the fistula formation. Here is the picture of the erythema nodosum. These are the small raised area on the leg area which are the red hyperemic. These are the erythema nodosum. This is the pyoderma gangrenosum. This is the ulcer on the leg which is non-healing. This is the pyoderma gangrenosum. Gangrene means blackish discoloration of the skin. So ulcer which converted into the blackish area, gangrenous conversion. So this is usually occurred in the Crohn disease. These are the aphthous ulcer, mouth ulcer. This is the episcleritis. We can say red eye. The eye is inflamed. In the eye manifestation is the redness in the eyes, which is episcleritis. Other part of inflammatory bowel disease is the ulcerative colitis. Second type is the ulcerative colitis. It has the variable severity, variable presentation according to the severity, and it is also a chronic disease. Smoking usually protect this disease, which is contrast with the Crohn disease, where smoking increase the disease activity. Usually patient presents with the diarrhea or rectal bleeding or tenesmus or passage of the mucus, crampy abdominal pains. These are all manifestation of the large intestinal infection. So patient presents usually the bleeding per rectum. Other is the anemia and hypoalbuminemia occur in this disease, and weight loss also occur because the food contents are not absorbed. Moreover, it is a chronic disease. Its variant is the fulminant colitis, where the disease activity is worse and severe disease activity. The intestine becomes swell up and large, and the absorption of the food contents is stopped, and the patient present with the distended abdominal and intestinal features of the intestinal obstruction. So it is a medical emergency. Usually fulminant colitis is associated with ulcerative colitis. I am not saying Crohn disease. Mind it, words are very important. Fulminant colitis is associated with ulcerative colitis. This is the brief presentation. Diarrhea and bloody stools, abdominal pain, loss of appetite and weight loss, urgency, tenesmus. Patient has that again and again, goes to the bathroom. Low levels of energy and fatigue because of repeated diarrhea. Patients' fluid contents are reduced, energy is lost in the diarrhea, and patient have the low energy and fatigue. So this is the types of the colitis: ulcerative colitis, proctitis. Terminal part of the intestine is affected. Proctosigmoiditis means anal canal, sigmoid colon is affected. Distal colitis means descending colon is also involved. Extensive colitis, transverse colon is also involved. And pancolitis, ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon and anal canal, all is affected in the pancolitis. This is the briefly the types of the ulcerative colitis according to the which area is affected in the ulcerative colitis. Now we see the healthy colon. This is the colonoscopic picture. Healthy colon, moderate colitis you see here and there the ulcers, but in between this is the normal, and this is a severe colitis. You see the picture of the by the colonoscopically. No, because ulcerative colitis is very common as compared to Crohn disease, so its disease severity is divided into the three main types: mild, moderate and severe. This is according to the clinical and laboratory presentation, means whatsoever the patient present to us and what laboratory data comes to us, we divide it into the mainly the three types: mild, moderate and severe. First is the stool frequency, means per number of stools per day. In mild type, less than 4, 4 to 6 is the moderate, and more than 6 with bloody, it is the severe variety. Pulse rate usually less than 90 is the mild, 90 to 100 mean moderate, and more than 100 is the severe. Weight loss, none mild variety, mild cases patient weight loss is none, no weight loss. 1 to 10% of the original weight is the moderate, and more than 10% of the original weight is the severe disease. Temperature in Fahrenheit normal, 99 to 100 in the moderate, more than 100 is the severe variety. ESR, which is done CBC with ESR, ESR is less than 20, 20 to 30 is the moderate, more than 30 is the severe. Hematocrit normal, 30 to 40% is the moderate, and less than 30 is the severe variety. Albumin normal is the mild cases, 3.5 to 3 is the moderate, less than 3 is the in the severe case. So we assess the disease severity because we are planning the treatment for this patient. So we divide the disease into three main grades: mild, moderate, severe, and then we plan for the treatment according to the severity of the disease. Differential diagnosis of the this type of the diarrhea is the irritable bowel disease, which I have already told you in my previous lecture. Celiac disease, this is also discussed. Appendicitis, because in Crohn disease, right iliac fossa mass or pain is the presentation of the Crohn disease. This confused us with the appendicitis. Intestinal lymphoma, sometimes mass like presentation in the Crohn disease, it confused with the intestinal lymphoma. HIV patient usually have the diarrhea, and which is and all the tests in our investigations are normal. Ischemic colitis means some area the bleeding mean blood supplies goes away due to some clot, and the patient has the ischemic colitis, and the bloody diarrhea occur in this case also. Infection, Yersinia, enterocolitis and tuberculosis, and amoeba histolytica, chlamydia, Clostridia difficile and cytomegalovirus also produce the diarrheal symptom and intestinal symptoms, which confused with the ulcerative colitis and Crohn disease. Investigation which usually perform in this disease are the values which reflect the inflammatory disease activity or nutritional complication. So the inflammatory markers, hematocrit, CBC with ESR, which is usually raised, serum albumin, which is usually low in the severe disease. So we perform these investigations. Stool examination to exclude other diseases, ova, cyst, parasite, bacteria. In stool examination, we perform these tests. Stool culture is done, and bacterial toxin, especially clostridial toxins, is performed to exclude the clostridial infections. Other investigation which are the specific for the disease is the colonoscopy. We perform the colonoscopy to see the inside of the intestine. Histopathology, we take the biopsy of the inflamed area and we see the what is the disease. Radiological investigations are the barium enema study and upper GI series is barium meal follow through. CT scan and MRI enterography we perform, and capsule imaging is a new technique by which we can see inside of the intestine. So these are, we can say that the specific investigation. Whenever the examiner want to ask you what per test you will perform, you divide it in two parts. General investigations are the CBC with ESR and albumin, and stool examination for ova, cyst and culture done. And the other is the investigation is the colonoscopy, histopathological test, radiological test and capsule imaging. You have to write all these investigations, specific investigations and general investigations. So this is a picture of the colonoscope. Colonoscopy is done. Colonoscopy is a camera with, attached with a tube, and you pass from the per anal, and the colonoscopy goes above from the rectum, sigmoid colon, descending colon, transverse colon, and the this is the ascending colon. This is the camera and light source here. You can see actual visualize the inside of the colon. So colonoscopy is the very important investigation, because when camera you see the inflamed area and you take out the biopsy from this that area, and you perform then histopathological test. This is the abdominal plane X-ray film. You see the sometimes the perforation occur. This is plane film will give you clue, and air fluid levels when the intestine is obstruction, and the you see the dilated gut. These are the picture of the dilated gut, which occur usually in the toxic megacolon or fulminant fulminant inflammation of the colon. So this is a plain X-ray film which gives you the clues of the disease severity. So sometimes complication occur like intestinal perforation. You see the air fluid levels and air under the diaphragm with the help of plain X-ray. Moreover, plain X-ray at in the severe fulminant disease gives you the picture where you can see the air in the gut, in the colon, intestine, and multiple air in the colon. You can see the this is the acute inflamed gut. This is the picture of the cobblestone appearance. This is the actually the cobblestones, and you see in the barium meal follow through picture where you see the cobblestone appearance in the barium meal studies. This is the area, you can see this is the stone, and this is the in between area of the stones. So this picture resembles with this picture, so we call that the cobblestone appearance occur in the Crohn's disease when you perform the barium meal and follow through study. Other important picture is the sign in the Crohn's disease is the string sign. The inflammation gut is inflamed, and the area of the lumen is narrowed down, and the contrast material when goes in the that area, it gives a string lying picture. So the string appearance in barium meal follow through is important clue for the Crohn's disease. Here you see the in the Crohn's disease large gut area. This is the area you see that the colon is inflamed, and the whole of the colon is affected. There is no area in between the colon which is the normal. This is the pseudo polyps formation in the ulcerative colitis. This is the picture. You see the small polyps formation. So these are called the pseudo polyps in the ulcerative colitis. This is the picture of the ulcerative colitis, which is the inflamed, and this is the picture of the colon in the colonoscopic picture of the intestine. Here you see the it looks like this one, and in the Crohn's disease it looks like this. You see the skip lesions. Some area is affected and some area is normal. While in ulcerative colitis, you whenever disease start, it goes away without skipping normal areas. This is the histopathological picture where the granuloma formation occur, especially in the Crohn's disease, which is the specialty of the Crohn's disease, that granuloma formation. While crypt abscess form in the ulcerative colitis. This is the picture of the colon in the normal colon. In ulcerative colitis, you see only the mucosa is affected, while in the Crohn disease, pancolitis means all the layer of the intestine, mucosa, submucosa, muscularis, all the layers are affected in the Crohn disease. This is a picture of the new technique which will soon come in Pakistan, is the capsule endoscopy. This is a capsule and camera is attached and there is a recorder. Patient ingest with a small sip of the water. It goes into the intestine, in the stomach, a small gut, large gut, and it is ultimately excreted. Here the picture, that is capsule is inside the gut. It takes the picture of the gut and recording is done, and then we can recording is seen on the TV screen, and we can see that which area of the gut is affected by the disease part. This is the capsule endoscopy. Now the complication of the disease, the complications are the abscess formation, sometimes interest because gut is inflamed, obstruction formation, abdominal and rectovaginal fistula formation, perianal disease, malabsorption disease, sometimes it is converted into the carcinoma, and sometimes the bleeding occur, massive hemorrhage occur, and one of the complication of the ulcerative colitis is the toxic megacolon formation, when the gut is inflamed and it becomes so much large inside, sometimes it can perforate. So these are the complication of the inflammatory bowel disease. Here is the picture. You see the perianal abscess formation. Sometimes abscess formation occur in this area. Sometimes abscess occur formation in the gluteal area, and sometimes abscess formation in the perianal area. Means this is the anal canal, and it is around the anal canal the abscess formation. Here is the picture. This is the picture. This is the anal canal, and this is the abscess formation in this area. Whenever the abscess formation occur in the perianal area, you must consider for the inflammatory bowel disease. You must look for the inflammatory bowel disease. These abscesses are not small thing. You have to look for the cause. This is a picture of the toxic megacolon. The colon is inflamed and it is filled with the air, and the chances that sometimes it perforate and produce the peritonitis. Now the last part is the treatment of the disease. Ulcerative colitis treatment is the 5-aminosalicylic acid which comes in the mesalamine. This is the topically active inflammatory agents. This is suitable for both ulcerative colitis and Crohn disease. It induces the remission and maintain the remissions. So it can, when the disease is active, we give this one drug, and for maintenance therapy this drug is continued. It is rapidly absorbed from the intestine, especially from the intestine. When we give it per oral, it is rapidly absorbed. Mode of delivery is both in the enema form and oral control tablets, which are also available with the name of the Pentasa. Drugs is the sulfasalazine and olcelazine. These are also available in the market for the oral preparations. Other drug which is employed for in the ulcerative colitis is the topical corticosteroids in the form of enema, hydrocortisone enema or budesonide enema. Oral drugs which are used are the prednisolone, methylprednisolone, budesonide, and intravenous prednisolone, which come in the name of the injection Decadron or dexamethasone, methylprednisolone. These are all available in the market. They are given by the injectable way, and these are the oral drugs which are given by the per oral ways. Other drugs, which class of the drug which is used in this disease, is the mercaptopurine, azathioprine, or methotrexate. Other are the biological agents. These are the tumor necrosing factor, the infliximab, adalimumab, and antigrains are the natalizumab and vedolizumab. These are basically the antibodies which are against the antibodies which are producing the disease. The treatment of the Crohn's disease. In the Crohn's disease is also a lifelong disease. Frequently exacerbation and remissions occur. No specific therapy is occur, but we give the treatment just like the ulcerative drugs which are used in the ulcerative colitis. We give the symptomatic improvement drugs which produce a symptomatic improvement in this disease. Then is the nutrition. In the nutritional part, we give the advise the patient to use the small frequent meals, and the liquid contents should be increased, and avoid, especially this is very important, avoid oily diets. Means oil is we ask them to avoid the oily diets and low roughage diet. And nutritional supplements like the B complex tablets are given in, and to these patients. And the, for the sometimes the disease is when the severe disease, we give the enteral therapy. Means the nasogastric tube is passed, and the nutrition is given with the help of the nasogastric tube. Sometimes the disease is very severe, and the severe fulminant disease, we give the parenteral therapy. Means the nutrition is given in the with the help of IV cannula is passed. Basically in this disease, in this part, we pass the cannula directly into the subclavian veins, which is and the nutrition is form of the amino veil or lipofundin. This is given directly with the help of the venous roots. And other is the, especially in the patients with the going to the surgery and high output fistula or severe disease, this method of treatment, parenteral treatment, is employed. So in parenteral CVP line, which is known as a CVP line is passed, and the food is given in this way. Foods available are amino veil, lipofundin, these are all available foods, and even dextrose waters are given with the help of the central venous lines. Tube, NG tube is passed. But in parenteral is very important. You must remember that sometimes the patient is given food with the help of parenteral nutrition. Other is the symptomatic medication. Patient have the diarrhea, we give the bile sequestrants like cholestyramine. Antibacterial agents like antibiotics are given to these patients to reduce the overgrowth. In the first part of the lecture, I have told you that antibiotics cause the improvement. So they have the bacteria, have the relationship with the disease activity, but exact relationship is not known. Antidiarrheal agents such as loperamide is used. Patient have the abscess and perianal abscess, we give the antibiotics and metronidazole, and sometimes surgically the abscesses are drained. And some fistula are formed, they are surgically removed. Specific drugs for the induction of the disease is the 5-amino salicylic acid and corticosteroids are given. And immune modulating drugs and biological drugs. Immune modulating are the azathioprine, cyclosporine, and biological agents are the tumor necrosis factor and antibodies therapy is given to induce the disease. Disease is very active. When the disease is very active, so they, to cause the remission in the disease, we give these drugs for the as a treatment for these patients. And for the maintenance, when the disease is slowed down, we give the maintenance therapy of the 5-amino salicylic acids or corticosteroids are given. Sometimes the surgery is indicated. In these cases, the patient have the severe disease active, or some the abscesses formation in the abdominal cavity, or some massive bleeding occur. So, or sometimes intestinal obstruction occur. In all these cases, we take the help of the surgeon for the disease activity. Because if the surgery is not employed in this stage or you delayed it, the this can cause the death of the patient. So, in this, when the disease patient have the abscess formation or massive bleeding, we take the help of the surgeon. When the patient have the severe fulminant disease, symptomatic or the medical management is that we give the antipyretic. Patient have the dehydration, we give the fluid to these patients, and the patient have the bleeding, we give the blood transfusion is required in these patients. Fulminant colitis is diagnosed because in this case the patient have the toxic megacolon, and we take the x-ray of the patient's plain x-ray of the patient. I'm showing you the plain x-ray. This is the toxic megacolon. We take the diameter. If it is more than 6 cm, then we diagnose it as the toxic megacolon. Toxic megacolon is a medical emergency, and if this is not treated immediately, this can lead to the death of the patient. So, toxic megacolon, if the colonic dilatation is more than 6 mm, it is a severe disease, and there is a risk of perforation, and this perforation can lead to the death of the patient. So we take the help of the surgeon. So but before the surgical help, you applied for the NPO, means nothing per hour or over, and IV nutrition and IV fluids are given to these patients, and fluid and electrolyte imbalance means sodium potassium imbalance is corrected with the help of normal saline, and if the bleeding is going on, we give the IV blood transfusion is done in this case. And the other is the, if the patient has the infection, we give the antibiotics for the treatment of the infections. And the more important is the surgical consultation. We take the help of the surgeon, because in this case, if the surgery is delayed, this can lead to the death of the patient. And other part is the, we give also the steroids to these patients, and tumor necrosis factor alpha therapies, immunosuppressive therapy, is all these things are employed in these complications. So not only the surgeon, means it is a disease occur in this stage, both physician and surgeon work together to treat the patient, to save the life of the patient. So colostomy, this is the picture I have shown you. Surgeon usually perform the colostomies in these patients. Colostomy bags means intestinal part is taken out of the taken out, and bag is attached to this part of the intestine, and whatsoever is eaten, it is excreted from this part of the colon, because colon is taken out of the abdomen and is collected in this bag, and its bag is then removed. So it's a artificial pathway is formed for the excretion of the patient. This is done with the help of the surgeon. This is the colostomy. So this is all the disease activity, disease of ulcerative colitis and Crohn disease. This is very important, but thanks to God that cases are rare in the Asian societies. In Pakistan, it is mostly in the Western societies. So because its end is very horrible, that patient have the colostomy bags. This is very say you are seeing that this is a person which first performed the colostomy, and after a few years, patient's mass, body mass is severe weight loss occur. So this is a very this is the only the, we can say this is the life saving procedure which is performed. Thank you. If you have any questions or queries, you can send to me in my WhatsApp group. Thank you very much.